God, praise God. And let the people of God say amen, amen. I welcome you to The Bread Broadcast, a Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we exhort, we edify, and challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today we are going to be talking about a disciple's journey. A disciple's journey. And when we are talking about disciple of Jesus Christ, that's talking about people who follow the doctrine, they practice the doctrines of Jesus Christ, all right? And our case study will be Apostle Paul, that great apostle, the apostle of the Gentiles. But before we go into it, let us pray. Father, we thank you. Lord, we ask that you will open our eyes to your word and use your word to build your character in us. Help us, Holy Spirit. Give us the heart of understanding. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. All right, a disciple's journey. And the case study against Apostle Paul. And our foundation text is taken from the book of Psalms, chapter 49. I will read from verse 7 to verse 9. Psalm 49, verses 7 to 9. It says, none of them can by any means redeem his brother, nor give to God a ransom for him. For the redemption of their souls is costly, and it shall cease forever. Another translation says, not enough money for God to say that's enough to pay for a soul. That he should continue to live eternally and not see the pit. Now, anywhere you see the pit in the Bible, it's talking about death, okay? So how does a disciple's journey start? Number one, saved by grace in him. The salvation of a believer in Christ Jesus is from a source, okay? The source is God's grace through Christ Jesus. Jesus died the death of a sinner, even though, watch this closely, he never sinned. He never. He asked the Pharisees, his enemies at the time, which one among you has ever seen me doing anything wrong? And they said, no. Pontius Pilate, he said, this man is innocent. Why do you want me to crucify him? You see, Jesus had a good witness before the people among whom he lived, even though they hated him. But nobody could say, you sinned. You see, so is proven. But Jesus died a sinner's death, even though he was not, because he loved us. Now watch this. Through Christ's death, the power of sin, Satan, death, and hell were destroyed. Hallelujah. Because Christ's sacrificial death, watch this, fulfilled God's demand for justice. You see, God is holy and pure. He will not let anything pass by. It's not going to happen. And you and I, we cannot pay for that. And Jesus said, because I'm sinless, I'm going to represent them. I will die their death. Okay? And when he died, God said, paid in full. You satisfied my demand for justice. And so the power of the devil, sin, hell, and death were destroyed ever since. Salvation has been through Jesus and Him alone. Go and check all the religions of this world, which are false. Nobody ever died for those who asked them to believe in them, only Jesus. When Apostle Paul realized this truth, that Jesus died for sinners, he forsook the trust which he had reposed in his religious works as a Pharisee and received Jesus Christ. When Jesus, listen up close, becomes the owner of your soul, this is the physical beginning of a spiritual journey as Christ's disciple on earth. When I say Jesus, I give my heart to you, and Jesus became the owner of my soul, that was the beginning of my journey as a disciple. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. We stop at 9. If you're a Bible student, you are saying that right now. Ephesians 2, verse 8, we stop at 9. For by grace you have been saved. By grace have been saved through faith. And that not of yourselves. Oh no, I don't have any good thing in my hand to have saved me. Oh, forget it. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast, you see. I was talking to somebody one day, and he said, well, God will look at all the good things I've done, and that will allow me to come to heaven. And I said, really? I'll put it to you that Osama bin Laden and what's his name now? The one in Germany, Adolf Hitler, they were nice to some people. We heard that Bin Laden paid school fees of some kids, poor kids. Now, so I put it to that young man. Will God now say, because Bin Laden paid the school fees of some poor kids in Afghanistan, Bin Laden, come on into heaven? And he was looking at me, you see. So no good works are good enough to bring you to heaven. No. Except through the source alone, Jesus Christ. When you put your faith in Jesus, that is the beginning of your journey as a disciple. He paid our sin debt to God when he died a death on the cross. Let's say that again, it's so beautiful. He paid our sin debt to God when he, Jesus, died a death on the cross. Moving on. Saved from blame of sin. So when you give your life to Jesus, Jesus gives you the gift of salvation. And then the next phase is that you are saved from blame of sin. The salvation of a believer in Christ Jesus is specific. It's not something here and there. No, it is specific. We are saved from the penalty of the sin which came upon us through Adam. We became partakers in this penalty because everyone is born with the natural tendency to sin as Adam's children. You want to argue, huh? Do you want to argue that? The judgment for that is eternal separation from God and life in hell. Fire. Listen up. If there's anything that I deserve, if there's anything that you deserve, it's the lake of fire. Uh-huh. Because we all have these natural tendencies in us through Adam, who gave us his crooked DNA, to sin. But thanks be to God, Jesus came purposely to stop whoever believes in him from paying this spiritual eternal death penalty. Hallelujah. God removes the debt of sin from your account, when you believe in Jesus, he did, when I gave my life to Jesus, he cleaned up my sin. I'm perfect before God, you see?
See what?
Yeah. Because when I said, Jesus, take over my soul, and I gave my soul to Jesus, Christ put his garment of perfectness, of righteousness, upon me. You see? So when God looks at Josephine Zion, he doesn't see Josephine Zion. He sees the garment of Jesus' righteousness covering me from head to toe. And God says, she's perfect. You see? This was how a former murderer and a persecutor of Christians, like Saul of Tarsus, who later became Apostle Paul, was saved from the death penalty of murder and other sins, and was able to receive the promise of life eternal, you see. Somebody was asking me, but if Jesus paid for your sins, how about the sins you commit after you become a Christian? Jesus paid for all the sins from when you have been born until you are going to take your last breath, if you believe in it. So the garment is still there, covering you up, you see. This is the spiritual result of a physical decision to become Christ's disciple on earth. That is the result of you giving your life to Jesus, is that you are stopped from going to the lake of fire, you see. You are saved from the blame of sin. Let's go to John chapter 3, verse 18. The gospel according to St. John chapter 3, verse 18. He who believes in him, in Jesus, is not condemned. But he who does not believe, listen up, I didn't write this, is condemned already. Jesus himself said this to Nicodemus, okay? Because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. So if you are saying, I don't believe in that you're Jesus, listen now. The Bible says you are condemned already. It's not that you are going to be lost. You already lost. But that can change. That can change. To believe unto Christ is to be redeemed unto life. Let me back up and tell you that again, to give you hope in Christ Jesus. If you are still listening to me, you are not dead yet, you can still change the course of your life from the lake of fire to heaven. To believe unto Christ is to be redeemed unto life. Moving on. We are saved for praise as we live. Hallelujah. The salvation of a believer in Christ Jesus is for a service. You see, Jesus will save you and say, sit there and wait until my kingdom comes. Oh no. Mm-mm-mm. Once you are saved for a purpose, for a service. Christ died to save us for one earthly purpose. Listen up. It doesn't matter what you do in your church, in your congregation, you are only saved for one purpose. Listen up real good. And the purpose is that Christ may live his life through you. That's it. That is the only purpose for which Jesus saved you when you asked him to save you, for which he saved me. When I said, Jesus, take this dirty Josephine Zion and make her your daughter, and he did. That's the only purpose. Now, I brought something. You know I'm a teacher, so I will do that. You see, watch me. What am I doing? I'm wearing a glove, okay? It's like wearing a hand glove. Are you watching? Whatever the hand is doing, listen, are you watching? You see what I'm doing? See, I'm pointing. Now I'm waving, okay? I'm waving to you. Hey, how are you? You see, whatever this glove is doing is not a glove. Without the hand, the glove is useless. It's lifeless. But because my hand, there's life in my hand, now the glove has come alive. Guess what? Jesus is the hand. All right? Now, I'm not saying my hand is just an example. Jesus is the hand. And if you are a believer, a disciple of Jesus, you are the glove. You see, look at the glove. It's useless. It's, you know, can't do anything. It's lifeless. But put your hand there, it comes alive. This is what Jesus, this is the reason he saved me. This is the reason he saved you. So he can move through us as the glove, you see. As we live every day, through prayer and Bible study, our character changes and we start to act like Jesus every day. This is a slow, lifelong process called transformation, you see. Apostle Paul, who was once a persecutor of Christians, became such a gentle disciple of Jesus. He was stoned, beaten, imprisoned, shipwrecked, and eventually he was killed in Rome for the gospel of Jesus Christ. This was a one-time Osama bin Laden, a one-time terrorist. But when Jesus came into Apostle Paul's life and Jesus began to increase his work in the life of Apostle Paul, his life began to change. So much so, he began to act like Jesus, gentle with people, teaching people about Jesus, and they started dealing with him anyhow, you see. Paul's transformation shocked others who had known his previous evil lifestyle to be amazed, you see. In other words, they were like, wow, this God must be real, you see. This change in Apostle Paul challenged them to consider becoming disciples too. This is the spiritual reason for which we live a different life as Christ's disciple on earth. I always tell people, if you call yourself a Christian and your life has not been changed in any way, you are still the same person you were before you became a Christian. Listen up, you are not yet a Christian. But I said the sinner's prayer. So, that doesn't mean it came from your heart. If indeed Jesus has taken over your soul, if indeed he has taken over your heart, of necessity, your life must be altered. Your life must be changed, you see. Let's go to Acts chapter 9, verse 21. Acts 9, 21. Then all who heard were amazed and said, now, this is talking about son of Tarsus, now Apostle Paul. Is this not he who destroyed those who called on this name in Jerusalem and has come here for that purpose, so that he might bring them bound to the chief priest? What happened? Wasn't it the Bin Laden that came to kill Christians in Damascus? And now he's preaching the same Jesus? Point to him. You see, that is transformation. Transformation in one's heart brings alteration in one's act. Let me say that again for all you pagans in the pews on church, pews on Sundays. You go to church, there's no change in your behavior. You go to church and you are casting a reflection on Jesus. Because your unbelieving colleagues at work, they behave better than you. Listen up. Transformation in one's heart brings alteration in one's act. So get your act together if you're a fake Christian, if there's no transformation in your life, and get saved in the real sense. Because that's the only purpose for which Christ is saving all his children. Amen. Now, the last part where we finish our journey as a disciple of Jesus Christ is, this is beautiful, saved to go to him. Hallelujah. the salvation of a believer in Christ Jesus is secured. You see, Muslims will tell you they don't know if they are going to make it to their paradise until they weigh their good works on the scale. May I tell you, there's no scale. Because every good thing that you could say you did, listen up. God said it's never going to be perfect because it's coming from an imperfect person. You see? So the only way you can come in is through the perfect God, Jesus, the God-man. You see? So if you believe in those religions where they will tell you you change from a person to an animal, may I ask you, if you're a Buddhist, what was your last sin for your God, your Buddha, to make you a human being in your current life? What was your sin in the last life? Huh? You see, the only way to be sure that after death, you are going to live happily ever after is through Jesus Christ, because we are secured as his disciples. Christ not only died to save us from eternal death, hallelujah, but also he died that we may come to where he is in heaven. Every genuine believer in Christ Jesus is going somewhere. Come on now. We are going somewhere if you're a disciple of Jesus. This is a specific place and location. It's called heaven. We have eternity to look forward to with Jesus Christ. We have a place to look forward to where there will be no more bodily pains, no more emotional stress, no more financial pressures or spiritual oppressions. I am so looking forward. Oh, Lord have mercy. We have this assurance because Jesus said the Holy Spirit inside the heart of any believer in Christ Jesus is the sign needed to know if our name is on heaven's residence list. It doesn't matter who you are. I say that on this program. Are you a preacher, pastor, or the Pope? Listen, the only way you can be sure that you are secured afterlife is if the Holy Spirit is in you, and you will know. You will know. If you don't have the Holy Spirit and you mount the pulpit every Sunday to preach, listen up, you're going nowhere, but you can change, okay? To not have the Holy Spirit in your heart is the sign that your name is not written in heaven's book, the Lamb's book of life. Mm-mm. Heaven is the ultimate destination of the spiritual journey started in Christ Jesus as his disciples on earth. Hallelujah. I when I talk about heaven, I can't contain myself. I've got to be honest with you, because I'm really looking forward. First Thessalonians chapter 4 verse 16, we stop at 17. First Thessalonians chapter 4 verse 16 to 17. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, hallelujah, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. You see, my grandmama will rise first because she's dead, but she's in heaven now. You see, all the loved ones, they will rise first. Those who died in Christ, okay? Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up, that is snatched up. That's where we got the word rapture. Together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. To be away from earth in him is to be arrayed from earth with him. Let me say that slowly. It's so beautiful. To be away from earth in him is to be arrayed from earth with him. The moment a child of God closes his or her eyes, immediately, as they close their eyes here, guess what? They are arrayed in heaven with Christ Jesus in the beautiful, praise God. All right, what does a disciple's journey look like? Now we are talking about what we have done so far. Number one, we are saved by grace. Amen. We can only be saved by believing in Jesus alone. So let me answer the question, is Jesus the only way to heaven? Yes, with a capitalized Y, yes. This is the beginning of a disciple's spiritual journey. We are saved from blame of sin. Christ's righteousness is given to us and our sins are removed at salvation. This is the spiritual result of salvation. We are saved for praise as we live. This is the spiritual reason and the physical evidence of salvation. Christ empowers us to act like Him, to challenge the unbelievers around us to salvation. Saved to go to Him. This is the final part of our spiritual journey, started as Christ's disciples on earth, when we get to live with Christ forevermore. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Are you a disciple of Jesus? Or a fan of Jesus? Huh? Only the Lord's disciples are the recognized ones in heaven. Where are you on the spiritual scale? You see, a fan can like somebody for what they do, but a disciple, we want to be like their teacher. Big difference. Big difference. I like some soccer players. I like the way they play, but I don't want my life to be like theirs. Oh no, forget it. You see, listening to sermon doesn't make you a disciple of Jesus. Oh, forget it. Oh no. Living according to the Bible makes you a disciple of Jesus. Make amends if need be, before it is too late. Jesus may come today, I tell people. I'm serious. He may come today. Are you an unbeliever? You've never considered the claims of Jesus Christ, nor looked at the evidence of Christianity as written in the Bible. Huh? Is that your own problem? Huh? Do yourself a favor. Yes, you. Do you a favor. Check it out. Check it out. Come on now. It would be foolish to agree to go to jail without knowing why. Excuse me? What did I do? You want to know before they put the clinkers on your hands and take you to jail, you see? Or refuse to take an offer of dropping the charges if truly what they said you did, you did. But there's a way out. They want to drop the charges and they're offering you a way out. It would be foolish to say no, right? Okay, if you honestly want to know, you will find out. The evidence of the spiritual charges against you and the escape route called Jesus is in the Bible. How you can escape from the coming damnation, you see the evidence in the Bible. Start reading the book of John, the gospel according to John. I challenge you, read it slowly every day onto Revelation. The book of Revelation, start from there. It's not gonna be long. You will see your spiritual charges. You will see the penalty awaiting you. And then you see the escape route that Jesus has provided, and then make your choice, all right? But if you say, listen up, Josephine Zion, I'm not even going to take that long route. I am convicted already. I believe I'm a sinner and I need Jesus. A link is coming up. Follow that link and we'll meet you there for further instructions. All right? Let us pray. Jesus, you are so beautiful. You are so, so beautiful. And I personally say I love you. Thank you for saving me from the coming damnation. Thank you for saving all your children from the coming wrath. Keep us, O Lord, in your vineyard. Help us to be faithful. And as many that are considering turning their souls over to you, Father, receive them as your children. In Jesus' name, amen. I will see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.